Hello and welcome to My Weather World. Here I am in KCRA Studio A, and it's another fine day. It's looking pretty good outside right now. Let's start things off by taking a look at current conditions and what kind of weather we have going on right now, because we want to know what's going on in our weather world. So let's start things off by taking a look at our satellite imagery. This is showing us a picture from space, and what we're looking for here is we're looking at the clouds and we want to see what direction they're moving and how they're rotating. That's really important to see the direction that they're rotating. So if you look at this big picture, I see a couple of things that really stand out. You can see there's some clouds spinning around over here near St. Louis. And of course, that means if they're spinning around counterclockwise, that's an area of low pressure. And then I see another area over here off the Pacific Northwest, here just to the west of Washington and Oregon, and it's spinning around as well. And you can see the circulation as it spins around. What direction is it spinning? It's spinning counterclockwise. So we know there's an area of low pressure here, but there's a space in between. And what's interesting here is you see the clouds, they come up, they move over, and then they drop down. And so that rotation is clockwise. And so that tells me that there's what out here? There's a ridge of high pressure that's sitting out. And that's what hit us yesterday. We had high pressure over us yesterday. Temperatures warmed up into the mid 90s, got up to 94 degrees yesterday in Sacramento downtown area. So it was a very, very warm day for this time of year, but things are changing with the cloud cover coming in. So what can you guess is going to happen? Well, the warmer weather's moving off to the east, and we have what's moving in from the west is some cooler conditions. So how much cooler? Well, let's look at the temperatures. Right now, we're at 58 degrees in San Francisco, Fairfield 63 degrees, temperatures in the mid 60s in Sacramento. But look at this, as you go from Stockton to Modesto, it gets warmer and warmer the farther away you get from the Delta region. So what does that tell you? Well, it means we have a little bit of a Delta breeze. And so that's really helping to cool temperatures off from where we were yesterday. So we're looking at temperatures that are 15 degrees cooler this morning than they were yesterday morning at this exact same time. 7 degrees cooler in San Francisco, 11 degrees cooler in Sacramento. But you can see the farther away you get from the source of the coolness here, from the coast through the Delta on into the valley, temperatures, well, are getting closer to where we were yesterday. Modesto's right on par with where we were yesterday at this time, as well as Auburn. But all that's going to change with the cloud cover we have coming through. Cooler air is coming in behind it, and temperatures are going to continue to drop. But here's that breeze, that nice Delta breeze we look forward to help cool things off. Currently a sustained wind of 24 miles per hour. So that's a pretty good stiff wind making its way through Solano County and Contra Costa County. Those are areas that usually get the brunt of the wind as it makes its way into the valley. So that's what's going on with our weather right now. But let's go ahead and get to a question that I received the other day. So let's go over here to our question stool. And this is a question, actually, I've gotten quite a few in various ways. Just people that I know, people that have emailed me. I've had some messages that have been sent to me about this. And it's a pretty simple one to answer. This is from Mary Kay, though. I picked that one. It says, what is that star or planet that I see in the west? Well, that's a very good question, because if you go out in the evenings, it's very, very bright. You can't miss it. I'm sure if you've been out just after the sun goes down, you've looked off to the west and you can see that bright spot in the sky. And what it actually is, well, it's a planet. So let's go ahead and take a look at the direction that this is moving. And as we face west, here we are looking off to the west, you can see that after the sun goes down, you'll still have a little bit of glow, of course, of the sun as it makes its way over the horizon. But then this nice bright spot sparks off in the sky. And this is actually the planet Venus. And of course, Venus, does it give off its own light? No, it doesn't. It borrows light. And where does it borrow that light from? It borrows it from the sun. It reflects. It has a surface that's full of clouds. Venus is surrounded by a thick layer of clouds. And what do clouds do well? Well, they reflect very well. So that's why Venus can be so bright. And that's what we see in the evening sky. It also can be the morning star if you get up, depending on what side of the sun it's in its orbit. Now, after you look at Venus, look what else comes down behind it. Here we go. We have a waxing crescent moon. And this moon tonight is going to be also fairly bright. It's been fairly thin, but it's getting a little thicker, a little thicker, a little thicker as the days go on. And so it will be giving off some light, and it's chasing Venus towards the horizon. So you're going to be watching that. It's going to be moving that direction towards the west. And its light, does it give off its own light? No, it doesn't. It's just like Venus. Venus is actually the third brightest object that we typically can see in the sky, okay? The moon, that's usually the second brightest object that we see in the sky. What's the first brightest object? Well, after those go down, here comes the sun. The sun, of course, is the brightest object that we see in our sky. And it does not reflect the light. It's actually the source of all the light for those reflections. So both the Venus as well as the moon get their light from the sun. And they reflect that light, and we see that light here on Earth. And you're familiar with reflections, right? Well, we've talked in earlier episodes about another thing called a refraction. Now, refracted light. So we're going to talk about light and what we can do with it. And not only does it bounce off of things, but it also can be bent by things. So let's take a look at one of the ways that light can be bent. What we're looking at here is some light that's bent from a prism. So here's the source of light. That source of light is going through this glass prism, and you can see there's reflections. You have the bright light that's coming off of this prism. Well, that's all a reflection. But some of this light, as it goes through the prism, which has a different density than the air surrounding it, bends that light, and you can see some of that bent light right there. I'm trying to follow it. You can see it right there. You got the different colors of light, and then we're gonna show you this here. This also kind of looks like the rainbow color. So you start off with some red that turns to a little bit of orange, and then you have it yellow, and you can kind of see a little thin strip of green in there as it turns into blue, and that blue gets darker and then eventually turns into a violet. And one of the ways that I was always taught about the colors of the rainbow is you have to remember Roy G. Biv: red, orange, yellow, green, blue, indigo, and violet. Now, some more modern scientists want to take the indigo out of there, but I like it just because it's easier to remember that way. But you go from, again, the green to the lighter blue to the darker blue and then to the violet. So that's bending light, and that's the result. You can't see the light, of course, bending, but you can see the result of it bending. And what it does is it slows down the light wave, because all the colors of the rainbow are in the sun's white light that comes down here to the earth. And that's what creates us, one of the processes that helps to create the rainbow that we see, because the rain acts similar to a prism. But there's also another feature here. It also has reflection. So it uses refraction as well as reflection. Reflection and refraction. Those are two words that are important to remember, because without them, we wouldn't have things, you know, like rainbows. And we need to have those rainbows, because that's what makes, and when we have the rain, so beautiful, especially when we have the sun behind us. And that's where we have the low-lying areas of the sun as it comes down in low elevations. That's the best chance or opportunity that we have to get a reflection or a refraction. But there's other things too, besides rainbows that we see. There's other things called sun dogs. There's other things that are called, well, here's our rainbow, and this is actually a double rainbow. You see the rainbow colors here, but you can also make out a little one here. This is actually a picture that I took while I was out jogging one day, and the rain was coming in, and the sun was just coming up over the horizon, and it made for a beautiful rainbow, double rainbow that I could see. So there's the rainbow. Again, refraction, and then it reflects, and then it refracts again and comes towards the observer, which was me taking the picture. Here's another optical phenomenon that I saw one day. And what you need here is you need the sun off on the horizon, usually at low elevations. And then you have to have cirrus clouds, which are made out of ice crystals. And those ice crystals will bend the light. They'll refract the light. And so the sun's rays are coming through those crystals and bending them out here, and they're coming right into, again, my line of sight, and so I can see them. And so these crystals are actually bending the light and reflecting the light. And this is what's called a sun dog. This is one half of a sun dog. Typically, when you see a sun dog, if the sky is full of these high cirrus clouds, you'll see a bright spot of light on the right side of the sun and a bright spot of light on the left side of the sun. Well, this particular case, there weren't, the clouds kind of faded on the other side of the sun, so we didn't see it. So it was just this one. So it was kind of like a half a sun dog out there. But a lot of times when people first see these things, like, oh, this is something that hardly ever happens. It's so unusual to see. But they actually happen quite frequently. In fact, I saw it a number of times this winter where we had the high cirrus clouds coming through and I saw sun dogs. But not only do we see what's called sun dogs, those bright sights, those bright lights on either side of the sun, it's also called a perihelia or a false sun. But we also have things called halos, and halos are really cool. And again, this is something that actually happens quite a bit, but oftentimes it happens and we never really look directly at the sun, so you don't want to do that, and so you don't notice them. But occasionally catch them, especially if you have your polarized sunglasses on. Your polarized sunglasses make the light show up really well, that refracted light that's coming through these, again, high clouds made out of ice crystals. They're bending that light. And if you look really closely, you can actually see the colors here. There is some colors. You have the red kind of color on this side, and it turns into kind of more of a white or yellowish color. And then you can see a little bit of blue also. So there is some color refraction that's taking place right there. But that's a halo, and this is what's called a 22-degree halo, because that light is going through those ice crystals and it's being bent at an angle of 22 degrees. So those are just some of the optical phenomena that occur with the uses of reflection and refraction. Say those really fast together. And so those are things that we would, well, we wouldn't have if we didn't have reflection or refraction. Let's go ahead and talk a little bit more about that over here at the whiteboard, and the process that takes place as we, you know, talk about, well, what happens? Now, I know I've explained in the past how a rainbow works, but let's go ahead and quickly review. Again, what you want to have is you want to have the sun. In this case, we're going to have the sun right here. So we need to have the sun, and then we have our observer that's down here. And let's put them right here. There are the person standing, and they've got their little hat on there. All right, and then we need to have the rain. And so here we have a low-lying cloud. This is gonna produce our rain. And we get a little drop of water. We're gonna magnify that drop right here. Okay, so there's our raindrop. So the sun's light, what does it do? Well, it comes and it hits the raindrop, and that raindrop then bends the light. And so the light gets bent, and then it gets reflected off the back, and then it comes back out at an angle here and hits our eyeballs. And so we see that bent light. So this acts like a prism. I showed you that video where we had that prism and it was bending the light into the different colors of the rainbow. Well, each raindrop is doing that. It's bending that light, and so you can see the different colors of the rainbow by where those raindrops are located, because the light gets stretched out, because you have the red wavelengths that are moving slower than the blue wavelengths that are a much more higher energy, and so they move much more quickly. And so they get bent more than the longer wavelengths, which just don't get bent as much. And so that forms a rainbow. So this is refraction, reflection, and refraction. So let's talk about the sun dog. What's happening with the sun dog? Well, the sun dog, we have ice crystals. And let's get rid of this. So here the sun needs to be behind your head. And with a sun dog, the sun needs to be in front of you. So you're looking directly at the sun. So in this case, we can get rid of this line too. You have ice crystals. And what are ice crystals? What do they look like? Well, they come in different shapes and sizes, of course. But generally, they're a hexagonal. So we have a hexagon here. So we have six sides. And then we can draw that going out like that. And we can cut it across here. And cut it across here. So it looks somewhat like that. Can you draw a hexagon column? There we go. So the light comes through the column, hits that, comes through, and then gets bent. So it doesn't come straight through. When it goes to the column, it gets bent, and it gets bent at an angle of about 22 degrees. And so that's what, here's our observer down here, is going to see. There's this nice little cap. is that light that's coming through and being bent. And so this is going to create a halo. And again, it's just the area of bright light that is around the sun. It's because of the light that's being bent by these ice crystals. The other thing is the sun dog is made by plates. And again, plates are ice crystals, but they're out, they're elongated like that. So we have a crystal that's flatter. So it's like you take an ice crystal and you take this and you kind of cut it into a slice. So you have your column and it's cut into a slice. So they're kind of a different, again, length of crystal. And this then has also some reflective properties, which creates that bright spot that we see on the sides of the halos. Usually they're right about here on the sides of the 22 degree halos. They're right out here, and that reflects the light as well as the bending of the light. And so you get these two bright spots that occur. Let's just put these false suns right here. So it looks like a little sun that's right here and a little sun that's right over here. So that's what's going on with all of the optical phenomena that's in our skies. And so this is something that's interesting. So once, when I was a meteorologist and I learned about all this stuff, guess what I started seeing more of? I started seeing more of this stuff because I actually was looking for it more. But again, the important thing to remember, never look at the sun, but look at those areas beside the sun. Let's do some demonstrations. Maybe we can do a little magic here. We're gonna start off with this, and we're gonna use refraction to hopefully do a little fun demonstration. So here I have a Pyrex beaker, and I've got a little tiny beaker here. And what I'm gonna do is you're gonna see this as I'm putting it in the bigger beaker. So we're gonna go ahead and zoom in so we can watch this. And as I put it in the beaker, you're gonna see the smaller beaker fairly well. You see that as I go into the oil? This is actually canola oil that I'm using, and down here is water. And the thing I want to point out here is you can see that the oil is floating on top of the water. The reason why? Because the oil is less dense than the water that's underneath it. And so it's floating. And so you have two different densities. And as I put this little beaker, you can see the beaker. And there it is. I'm wiggling it around. And then I put it into the oil, and the oil eventually makes it disappear. What happened? Guess what? It's still there. I push it down a little further and you can see it there, but it almost fades away. It kind of looks like Wonder Woman's invisible jet. You can see some of the lines from the beaker on there. You can see the labeling on there, but the beaker itself, it's vanished. But no, it's still there. That's because of the index of refraction. The way that these different objects, they refract the light. The canola oil and this little Pyrex that I have here, this beaker that I have the same refraction index. And so when it's filled with air, when I first put it in, you can still see it because the air is bending the light at a different refraction index than the beaker itself. But when I completely submerge it in the oil, it's the same refraction index. And so the light just goes directly through. It doesn't bend the light differently, but it's still here, but now it's not, but it's still here, but now it's not. So that's what's going on. So that's refraction. And this is kind of a messy way to play with refraction, but it's kind of a fun way, and it's kind of neat to see how that works. So I'm gonna see if I can, this is just again oil, so it's just like if I were baking. I get oil all over myself when I do baking. So that's with the oil, and that's the refraction index. Another fun thing you can do is you can unleash the powers of water another way. And the other way is here. So here I have, this is the closest thing I could get to a column vase. It's best if you have the sides are straight up and down. You want a nice round vase. This one, it flares out a little bit, so it's not the best, but it still works. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna unleash the powers of water. And how we're going to do that is we are going to take this piece of paper with a pink little column here and a little blue rectangle on it here, and we're going to magically reverse them. Watch this. Here we go. So I have the paper, and you can see this. Oh, there we go. You can see it here. You've got the blue and you've got the pink rectangles. Watch as I put it into the water. Wait a minute, what happened here? So now you have the blue on this side and the pink on this side, but if I take it out of the water, what's going on? It changes. That, my friends, is refraction. Let's do another one. Here I have arrows. These arrows, you can see we have an up arrow and we have a down arrow. Now we introduce it to the water, and what's going to happen? You got the up arrow and the down arrow? Ooh, it changes. What's up is down, and what's down is up. What's going on here? Well, it's refraction. And if I want to get friendly, let's see, you do this. We've got this here. We can mix it up, and there we've got IH turning into a nice high. Again, explaining what's going on. Well, guess what? This cylinder here filled with water, it's acting like a magnifying glass, which refracts the light. It bends the light. And so as it bends the light, what it's doing is there's a focal point. Maybe we can go over here really quick and explain that. So, here we go. Light's coming through. This filled with water is acting like a lens, and it's bending the light. And so as it goes through, it's bending the light, and it gets to another point here where all those bends come together. This is the focal point. And then it switches or reverses the image. So in this case, I have an arrow that's going this way, and the tip of the arrow goes through and comes out the other side on this side. So now this is the tip of the arrow, and that's the back of the arrow. It goes through to the other side, so it reverses the image. So that's how it works. So this, again, this cylinder that I have filled with water acts like a magnifying glass, and it bends the light, and so it actually reverses the direction of the arrow because of the refraction that's taking place. So that's some of the fun that you can have with refraction and reflection. You can do lots of things with that as well. But thank you so much for your questions that you have. I love your questions. And if you have a question, especially from watching this episode, feel free to contact me. The best way to do it is via email. You can email me at dverdorn@hearst.com. That's D-V-E-R-D-O-O-R-N at Hearst, H-E-A-R-S-T.com. Or you can message me on Facebook. I'll read all your questions, and I would love to answer them all. So go ahead and get in contact with me. I'm looking forward to hearing from you. Now get out there and have a great day, and don't stop asking questions. Thanks for watching.